Jewish Education and Media is pleased to present L'Chaim, a program that highlights the people, issues, and events of importance to the Jewish community. Now here is your host, Rabbi Mark Golub.
I'm Mark Golub, and there are so many people in the Jewish world doing very creative work that expands our understanding of our world and of Jewish life. And one of these individuals is here with us on this edition of L'Chaim. I'm so pleased to welcome Talia Carner, a woman who's done some amazing work on behalf of women throughout the world, an international champion of human rights, and also a wonderful writer and the award-winning author of 4 novels. Talia is the former publisher of Savvy Woman magazine. She's been a professor of marketing at Long Island University, a marketing consultant to Fortune 500 companies, and Talia Carner was a member of the United States Information Agency mission to Russia. Which brings me to Talia's most recent novel, Hotel Moscow, a heart-stopping story of an American businesswoman named Brooke Fielding, who visits Russia in 1993 after the fall of communism, where there was a spirit of optimism about the possibilities of true democracy and capitalism becoming the new Russian Revolution. Here's what Talia Carner describes the Russia that serves as the setting of her novel, Hotel Moscow. This new Russia, Talia writes in Brooke Fielding's voice, was fighting for liberty, placing the individual's rights for happiness over the collective's good, and as it struggled to free itself from bigotry, so should she. From the opening chapter, however, which includes a frightening encounter with Russian soldiers at the airport, Brooke Fielding confronts a very different Russian reality. And as you're about to hear, it comes out of Talia's own harrowing experiences when she visited Russia in 1993. Hotel Moscow is not only a dramatic story of a suspense-filled 7-day stay in Russia, it's a penetrating exploration of the harsh lives Russians, especially Russian women, endured in the post-Gorbachev years, in a world that was still filled with anti-Semitism. And it offered Talia an opportunity to explore themes of faith, friendship, and heritage with her readers. And Talia, it's such a pleasure to have you at this table. Thank you for joining us. Mazal Tov on Hotel Moscow.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. But after such a wonderful introduction, I think you covered the entire subject.
No, there's so much I want to know about you, so much more. I want to begin with you as a human being, as a child. You're a Sabra. You were born in Israel. I believe I saw your 7th generation. Is that right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Tel Aviv?
I was born and grew up in Tel Aviv. My mother did too, but the family was a Jerusalemites.
Where was your family ultimately from?
Russia.
From Russia.
Reb Zalman Tzoref. Reb Zalman Solomon. They call him Batsoev because that's what he did, but Solomon was his name, arrived in 1794 from Russia.
Unbelievable.
His son, Yoel Solomon, was one of the 3 leaders of Jerusalem, of the Jewish community, and he and 2 other men were the ones who actually started to build the first neighborhood outside of the old city, outside the walls, because there was just no room. They also built that very famous synagogue, the one that was the first synagogue since the temple had been destroyed, called the Chorbe, the Chirba. That is he was one of those 3 men.
These are your ancestors.
Yes, so Yoel Solomon, there are streets in Jerusalem on his name and so on.
That's so amazing.
And as a result of that, of this prominence, our family is very well documented. About 15,000 names appear in 2 volumes of books.
You know, Talia, there is this argument going on in contemporary, not only America, throughout the world, suggesting that the Jews were not indigenous to Eretz Yisrael, what was then Palestine, but in terms of our own tradition, Eretz Yisrael. Here you have your own family going back to the end of the 18th century. When you hear discussions, whether it's on television or in some kind of social setting that you're in, and you hear people say, you know, the problem with Israel is the Jews came from Europe, they stole the land from the Palestinians, and that they have no right to be there. What goes through your mind and what do you feel?
First of all, the facts. The facts are that the area that is today's Israel was very sparsely inhabited by whatever the names they did. Were not the Palestinians, they didn't call themselves as such. Whoever they were, part of Arabs in within the Ottoman Empire, they were not that many. Also, in terms of facts, in 1900, for example, census by the Ottoman Empire, which still controlled the area, as well as new embassies that built at that time, it was the end of the Ottoman Empire and it was starting to fray. Different embassies were coming, jostling for control of that area. The number of population, for example, in Jerusalem, in all of those estimates and census, stand on approximately, I'll give you general numbers, 70,000 people living in Jerusalem in 1900, of which 45,000 were Jews, 15,000 Christians, and 10,000 Muslims. Now the Muslims said Jerusalem is ours. They were never, ever more than a minority. So those are the facts. As far as the greater Israel, not just Jerusalem, when the Jews began to arrive in the late 1800s, in the first Aliyah and the second Aliyah in the early 1900s, they started drying up swampland and built roads and so on. They started agriculture. All of the central area, which is today from Tel Aviv up to maybe Hedera, every place you see a eucalyptus tree was swampland, with malaria, flooded area. It was not an agricultural land. The Jews dried it up, put in eucalyptus trees and everything else in irrigation, and started to cultivate the land. As a result of that, there were new jobs. And that's when the Arabs began to arrive in big numbers.
It's very important, your point. Most of the Arabs who came were coming from other lands looking for work.
Yes, and the Jews gave them work because they were developing. The whole place was still very underdeveloped, but compared with what it had been before. So when you ask me, whoever says that, either they don't dare say it in front of me, or they have to listen to the facts. And the problem with people who do not want to know the facts, don't confuse me with facts, because I have a utopian view of the world, and I would like to see the Jews as the bad ones, and if you show me otherwise, then I am totally get discombobulated, then they are not the kind of people to ask me questions.
Mm-hmm. Your family goes back to the end of the 18th century, and then you're born in Tel Aviv. Who are your parents, and do you have siblings? What's your family like?
I had a mother who passed away 3 years ago, who was an exceptional woman, was very, very talented, had a very interesting history for herself. When she finished high school, she was a very, very good gymnast. She was trained as the first class of Wingate Institute as a gym teacher. But at that time, they didn't have the building, so they used the Herzliya High School for classes. They used the Hadassah swimming pool, the only swimming pool that existed in Israel. This is where today the building of the municipality stands, right there. But That's where it was. They used that for swimming and so on and so forth. And they were trained as Haganah commanders.
Your mother?
Yeah, because...
What was your mother's name?
Reviva Yofe.
Reviva?
Reviva. At any rate, she's had quite a few careers. And at 42, she started to paint, became a very, very successful artist. That by the time she died at the age of 88, she painted and sold literally thousands of paintings. I've never heard of anybody as prolific as she was. And she was working with tiny little brushes with the same speed that her mother used to crochet and knit. Her mother was my inspiration for Jerusalem Made, an untapped artistic genius. But today we are not talking about my previous novel. So
no, we'll get
not going to go there.
Although I want to know about everything. What was the Jewish character of your mother's home?
None.
Just Israeli.
Israeli.
Mm-hmm.
It's very interesting. We in Israel, the secular society of Israel, which was by far the great majority, now they are close to 20% who identify themselves as Orthodox. At that time, it was much smaller, very small percentage. It was a secular society, socialist society. Not my family was not socialist by any mean of the, but they were, the country was. At any rate, we had a Jewish identity that was so profound that is very different from the Jewish identity of an American secular Jew today or maybe then. We shared all the diaspora character, culture. We don't joke in Israel, and I say today I've left Israel 40 years ago, so it's not fair, but definitely we invented a new, or revived a language that didn't have curses. Because it came from the...
It was the Lashon Kodesh. You couldn't have curses.
So
but modern Hebrew was modern Hebrew.
It was modern Hebrew with its own jokes, with its own pronunciations by different accents. We laughed at that. We laughed at the bureaucracy, the nascent bureaucracy. We had the idiosyncrasy of the army. We had new jokes that were our own about all of that, new songs that celebrated every Zionist achievement, starting with the first swiveling water system irrigation that swiveled in the desert. It's one of the best, the best songs that you sing the horror to. So we had a very strong Zionist feeling. We had a sense of building a country, and I can't take credit, I must say, for my parents and grandparents who did all of that, but I was the first generation after the Holocaust. So we had a mission, and the mission was to be strong, happy, eat a lot of fruit and vegetable, and grow taller than our parents, and to create this country for not just for ourselves, but for the rest of the Jews, because they were coming. And coming they did. Israel started with 500,000, by the age of 10 had 2.5 million. Can you imagine? United States now absorbing, let's say, 1.5 billion people. It's unheard of in terms of what it did. And so that we had a great sense of mission. We were Jews through and through. We didn't need, but we resented the Orthodox who gave all the credit to God. Excuse me, they gave, young men gave their lives. The War of Independence was a huge loss of lives, and that was not the end. So we were secular.
Mm-hmm.
We believed in ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say that that's how I grew up.
Mm-hmm. You know, today, an Israeli might say that they're secular, and yet some secular Israelis will still have Shabbat in their homes in a very
right.
casual way.
Right.
Not in terms of halakha, not in terms of Jewish law. They know when the holidays are.
Of course.
For them, Sukkot and Shavuot. And in America, tell you now, almost no American Jew knows what Shavuot is. It comes and goes. Sukkot is a very minor holiday here. These were festivals in Israel. And, you know, there are people who say, if you haven't experienced Sukkot in Israel, you haven't experienced Sukkot. Was that in any way true for your family?
Absolutely. Sukkot was a big holiday for me and my friends. We would raid wherever we could to build a sukkah. And for 7 days, we walked around with a tray for breakfast and dinner to our sukkah. It was a kid's thing, but we had our sukkah.
Yes. How about Purim?
Purim, of course. My mother was fabulous with, you know, the artist. She created costumes that were really fantastic. That was before you could buy them in a store. But I would like to add that, yes, Israel, even today, all the secular people I know do not realize how Jewish they are.
Exactly.
Until it is confronted. And I could say about, for example, Passover is the most celebrated holiday. They read the Haggadah from beginning to end in Hebrew, of course. But when, but in the early 1990s, when there was about a million Jews arrived from Russia with absolutely no history of practicing Judaism or anything else, 10,000 of Jewish families opened their homes to the Russian immigrants, invited them to the Seder, and the secularized they were, they introduced those newcomers to the tradition that is an Israeli tradition. And that is how they got them to learn about being Jewish in the secular environment. So yes, I know young people who tell me, who refuse to get married because they don't want a rabbi in their wedding, in a variety of rebellious ways, which is sometimes understandable by the control of the orthodoxy over personal lives. But the fact is in between, and they live that version of being Jewish.
Okay. I want to separate two issues and ask you to comment on each one, and then I want to talk about the issues that are raised in Hotel Moscow. You have lived in America a long time. You're married to a wonderful guy, Ron Carner. You live in America. To what extent do you still feel that that being an Israeli is at the core of your being? Have you lived here so long that you sort of see yourself as an American? To what extent are you still Israeli? And the question is going to be put in the context of, when I see all of the things you've done in your life, there is something very worldly about you. I don't mean worldly in terms of money. I mean worldly in the sense that the concerns that seem to have interested you, driven you, to which you've given so much of your heart and your mind, are global issues, human rights issues, women's issues, issues of abuse of children. You've been to Russia. You've been to China. You've worked with the United States Information Agency. Your scope is of a global nature. So I will ask both questions at the same time. To what extent is Israeli still at the core of your being? And to what extent is particularism of Jewish part of your being?
I feel I'm a woman and I'm Jewish. Now, in the United States, and also because I still have an accent, an Israeli accent, they consider me Israeli. But when I arrive in Israel, and I must say that I have slightly an American accent in the way I speak Hebrew now, it's not just the accent, it's the melody and the use of words. I have a very good vocabulary. For some of the young people, it sounds archaic. Words that no longer being used. They consider me American. My dress, my hair, my mannerism, I seem to be American to them.
Talia, are you still Israeli?
I'm an Israeli because I have the perspective, I have the loyalty.
Yes.
The loyalty.
I want to now move to Hotel Moscow, which also is part of your story. The book takes place in 1993, and I don't know how many of our viewers remember that there was what's called a putsch. There was a sort of a coup that removed Boris Yeltsin. And our viewers know, and you know, that in addition to working with JBS, I had the privilege of creating the Russian Television Network of America that serves the large, almost exclusively Jewish, but not entirely Jewish, population of Russians, the vast majority of whom came in during Operation Exodus, when the doors of the Soviet Union were opened in 1990-91. In 1993, we're producing RTN, and I'm watching what is in essence, an entire regime change. Now, you're in Russia on a trip of a businesswoman nature, and that's the setting in which you write Hotel Moscow. And in reality, the reality of your life, I believe, you have an encounter. The details may not be the same, but there's an encounter where ultimately you have to escape from Russia of 1993. So I want you to first, I want you to share that story to the extent to which you can. And everybody always asks an author, how autobiographical is your novel? There's always some autobiographical material, and there's also what Isaac Bashever Singer told me he calls invention. So I want to know two things. Tell me about your own life in 1993, which, again, in some way is the genesis of what your character experiences in Hotel Moscow. And how much of this book do you feel is your attempt to novelize something that happened to you? To what extent are you trying to tell a different story?
What happened at that time, just after the fall of communism, the entire legal system, entire system was obliterated. Now we have a country with no laws. So he started creating about 1,400 laws a year to just fill up the gap. And a lot of them were not passing very well with the Duma, which was the Russian parliament. The Russian parliament by 1993 had been elected democratically, even though they came from the republics and places where it is not very clear how democratically the process had been versus being an apparatchik or person of influence, and they got themselves elected. But the fact is that overall it was considered a democratically elected parliament. Now he gets frustrated over the fact that he can't pass many of his laws. And he decided one day, you're fired. And he fires the parliament. Obviously, just like our President Obama cannot fire Congress, Congress is not going to leave the seats and say, okay, Mr. President, we accept being fired. No, it's not for him to fire. They started arguing, and he said, leave the building, and they said, no. And then he started bringing tanks, and he started bringing his army, and they locked themselves inside. Now, this is all going on for about 2 weeks at that time. Thousands of their supporters from the various republics that were still under Russian control started coming into the city. All that time, it was considered a political upheaval contained within the, all by it in the center of Moscow, and the State Department, our U.S. State Department, did not issue an alert or travel alert. That is when I left New York on a flight to Moscow. I was in a group of people, and 2 hours
You were part of a mission, were you not?
Yes, I was part of a mission, but it was composed of different people who were each had a different sponsor. Mine was the USIA. There were different, one was from the US Mint, one was from the Red Cross, and so on.
And what were you hoping to achieve on this
mission? Had a specific agenda of this workshop to give here and this workshop there and so on. I had a complete program that I had to execute. At any rate, 2 hours before we land, the uprising breaks. On the way from the airport to the city, we see over the a bridge, and we see white stuff flying in the air, which we realize are police shields. And we see pitchforks in the air. We see a whole big thing. We don't know that the uprising had started. This is pre-internet, pre-cell phones. And we ask our handlers, you know, whoever were the people who came to meet us at the airport, and we're now, and they were translators, there were a few people, what's going on? Oh, nothing. The bus turns around, brings us to the hotel. And from that point on, they created this vacuum around us where they did not want us to know anything. The next day when I called home, my son answers the phone, my stepson, Talia, where are you? What's going on? I said, Jonathan, what's the matter? I'm watching CNN. I said, tell me frame by frame what you're seeing. And he tells me, this is 5 o'clock in the afternoon in Russia, morning still in New York. And he tells me all of this. So at dinner, I tell the women what I heard. Our handlers tell us it's Western propaganda. And so we begin these English-speaking people who had been obviously exposed to television and U.S. Western culture were acting in the same Soviet approach of denial, lies, outright lies. The next morning, I said to the ladies at breakfast, we're going to a different program. We each had a different assignment. But at breakfast, we were together. I said, did you hear the tanks last night? I know my tanks. You ask me about my Israeli background. I know a tank when I hear one rolling down the street. So the handler said, no, that's no tanks. It's not. I said, well, what about the uprising? Tell us what's, a CNN in Russian was totally censored. We did have a television in Russian, and whatever, when you found CNN, it wasn't. It wasn't anything you could take out of it. There was something happening in Africa, which Mogadishu.
Mogadishu.
I think an American soldier was dragged through the streets. There were some other things happening. I think Michael Jordan was something. So you saw that on television. And I naively still argued with our handlers. No, we tell us what's going on. Give us the Russian, the Moscow time is in English, where they were supposed to bring it, why didn't you bring it, and so on. Well, that's when they decided I was a troublemaker. But again, I didn't get it. It took a long time, so yes,
you
got myself.
You didn't mean to be a troublemaker.
No, I just wanted to know information.
Right.
There's an uprising. Then the next day, after a harrowing experience, and I escaped and made my way.
What do you mean a harrowing experience?
This is all in the book. I actually, that brings it to the next question. Of all my novels, Hotel Moscow is the only one that's based upon personal experiences. Still, I am, as a character, Talia, I'm not in any of my books.
I do understand.
I know that many authors, especially beginner authors, cannot get them away from themselves. I'm lucky that I had enough imagination from the get-go to create characters that are their own person, whatever it was, a story that I needed to tell. In Hotel Moscow, I'm still not a character there, but I based it upon real experiences that happened, and at the time, I ended up writing them immediately soon after, so they were fresh. After the uprising was quelled by the third day, the militia arrived to supposedly clean the hotel off foreigners. And they decided that I was a foreigner, and therefore I should be, and I ran away. I was playing Scrabble. When I saw them, I saw 18 Kalashnikovs targeted towards me, I fled. Again, I know my Kalashnikovs, so
But you don't know where to flee.
My room happened to be right behind where I was playing Scrabble, where those guys came out of three elevators and had those machine guns pointed. So I got up. The other two women I was playing Scrabble with ran the other way and behind the elevator bank so they couldn't see where they were. And I'm trying with this long key, you know, those old skeleton key, they call them. I couldn't fit it. I was shaking. So they saw where I went in. And about half an hour later, our handler came to tell me that they want to throw me into jail to find out why I ran away, what did I have to hide? And I said, I didn't have anything to hide except I didn't want to have 18 Kalashnikovs. One of them is enough if it went off by mistake.
Was this a scary moment for you?
It was the most scariest moment. I would say when I said before, I'm not afraid. This was definitely
scary. This is something to be afraid of.
Really scary. And so it was a very scary situation. The next day, I fled the hotel without my luggage in sneakers and jeans and a bag in which I had bug spray for jail. You know, there are going to be a lot of cockroaches. And I had a granola bar and tea bags. And I hid all kind of money all over myself in small bills so I could pick up whichever I do to get my way out, which is what I did. And I made my way to the American embassy, and they whisked me out of the country. So that was, so this was an experience that was certainly something that I took with me. But what I also took with me from my first visit 6 months before, where I was with another organization called Alliance of America, Russian and American, Alliance of American and Russian Women. And it was a wonderful experience that lasted 14 days, not 4 days. And I had a wonderful connection with the Russian women. I had a lot of the workshops that I describe in the book came from both occasions, because I did teach, even in those 3 days under the uprising, I still taught. There were some events that I managed to get to, because I guess my handlers couldn't cancel them because I was the one to run them. It was a very confusing time.
Mm-hmm. When you decide to write a book, and this is your fourth novel, is it a story you want to tell? Or is the story a vehicle for a larger point you want to make? So that, for example, when you did Puppet Child, you were really dealing with a problem having to do with children. You've been enormously involved with a whole host of women's issues and the way women are mistreated, and you're trying to champion a different way in which the world will regard women. So I ask again, you know, why does Talia Carner become a novelist? And there are many reasons that people are driven to write. I'm asking you what you feel the drive is for you. Is it to tell a story? Are you a storyteller? Or is the story itself secondary to some socially driven message and an attempt to subtly use the story to change people's understanding and behavior?
Let me say that it takes me about 5 to 6 years to write a novel. It would be very hard to do to get on a soapbox to get an issue out. Maybe I would have been very effective working full-time on that issue for 5 or 6 years in different ways.
Very
if that were my goal. I would say that each of my novels starts for a different, somewhat of a little bit of a different reason. It is driven by the character in all cases. In Puppet Child, actually, the inspiration was the character of the judge. I wanted to understand this gregarious, outgoing man who thinks he has a mission and he has no clue how he destroys life. Now I went on to tell the story from the point of view of the victims. Yes, he's there too. He is also a point of view character, but by far secondary. China Doll started with one little thought, and that is how an adoptive parent is committed to a child, and to an adoptive child, from the minute the child is in her arms. And I said, where could that happen? Somebody throws a baby in your arms. Oh, in China, they have too many girls. And lo and behold, I get an invitation to go to China for the International Women's Conference in Beijing, 1995.
Coincidentally?
Yeah, I already had the idea. But now I'm thinking of China, and all of a sudden there's International Women's Conference in Beijing. How?
Beshert.
Yes. And there my attention got hijacked by the subject of that became Puppet Child. So I put China Doll aside, wrote Puppet Child. That's about the story of the judge I just mentioned. And then I went back to the Chinese theme and Chinese setting. But part of it was that I needed to create a distance. Because when I was in China, I was so overwhelmed by the notion of what I needed to tackle, and that is two government, the Chinese and American government, in cahoot with each other to return this baby to the orphanage where the death is assured, that I had to learn more about U.S.-China relationship. And I must say, I was overwhelmed by it, and I put it aside. But when I had a little bit of a distance, I was able to read books and go to lectures and start interviewing people about it and learn about it. And with that distance, I was able to write it. So the subject of infanticide came because of the International Women's Conference in Beijing.
How interesting. I understand then how you did China Doll. You wanted to deal with the issue of adoption. But something triggered that idea even before you were in China, and then, you know, a world opened up for you. Do you remember what it was that prompted you?
It's very personal. When I had my first daughter, I hated the pregnancy. I hated the 48-hour childbirth. I hated this whole thing. It was a time when doctors did not tell us what was going on with our bodies, which is very hard for people to understand today, when there was such a huge shift in the past 30 years. It was almost immediate with the feminist revolution, maybe, but we did not know, I did not know, I had no idea what was going on in me. It could have been an appendix, as far as I was concerned, that was kicking a few times. And then they put the baby in my arms, and I was a goner. And I thought that if I didn't need the pregnancy, I didn't need the childbirth, if just my hormonal stars had lined up at that moment, I would have loved this child. I would be totally committed to her. So that was an emotion that motherhood became the strongest emotion that I'd ever felt before or after. It is something that was foreign to me. I was not a particularly maternal person. I have a sister who's 14 years younger. I had nothing to do with her. While I was in high school, I didn't have to babysit for her, nothing. I didn't have those kind of emotions.
So you were surprised at what you felt?
I was taken by complete surprise. But I also felt that this was the commitment by an adoptive father, parent, is because my father adopted me, and we had a very strong connection, very small, strong bond that I might say he never had with that sister who was 14 years younger. It was, did not exist with her, that I felt that I understood it.
it seems to me it shapes personality. And that one of the reasons why women are both, they're human beings, men are human beings, we share this world, we share life, pain, joy, and death. But there's something we don't share in the same way, and that is bringing a child into the world. And it means that it shapes a woman differently than a man. Does that in any way resonate with you?
I must say, to be fair, there are a lot of wonderful women who do not bear children.
Yes, absolutely.
Either by choice or by circumstances.
Exactly.
So I wouldn't hold that childbearing as such a wonderful thing that you are blessed to have it, because then you're unblessed if you don't have it. I would say what it does is shaping cultures, because I go back to medieval times when medicine was practiced by midwives. They were the ones who understood, who knew about child pregnancy and childbirth, but they also learned to deal with pain, and they knew all kind of herbs, what to do, how to cook them, how to give them, how to monitor. They probably dealt with things like today, a breast cancer. They knew what it was. They probably couldn't do anything about it. But what happened was the mystery that you are bringing up totally threw the priests off. And they felt that these women, these midwives, who knew the secret of life, who controlled, who dealt with the blood. The blood was very scary to them. They wanted to be the healers. They wanted people to come and pay money for prayers. But instead, the real healing was done by women. So what did they do? They declared them as witches. Because otherwise, one day, they are going to turn straw into gold. And they burned them on the stake. And what they did, they burned on the stake. And if you think what it did to our Western culture, when the brightest and most competent women were being destroyed, what it did to our gene pools. So I think that this whole notion of childbirth and the mystery of life and the blood that accompanies it, either in menstruation or in through the process of childbearing, was so scary that it affected our culture. And until today, it is used against women in cultures that do not recognize women as equal human beings. And unfortunately, that is close to all over the world, because even in the United States of America, we don't have equal right amendment written into the Constitution. Women are not equal to men according to our Constitution. So how can we blame the 56 Muslim countries that sees women as inhuman?
No, but you're not
so
comparing
on
the United States to Muslim countries.
No, I'm saying the problem exists everywhere, even where we consider
ourselves.
Yes, but
ourselves to a very different degree.
Right, absolutely. But even in Scandinavian countries, where they've reached the closest in terms of closing the gap between men and women, if you talk to women in Norway or in Stockholm, in the main cities where they really have reached equality, supposedly to us, to our views, they tell you that there is still a gap, both in the public arena and in the private arena. Yes, they both, men and women, get time off upon the delivery, birth of a child, and so on and so forth, in a variety of ways. And women have a representation and legal representation, but where is the religious representation? We don't see that yet. Leadership in a religion is a very important part of what makes us human, yet women are still discounted in all major religions in big ways four major religions in terms of their role, including the Scandinavian countries. They're not very religious, but for what they have, they're still, it is dominant by men. So, yes, there are all kind of degrees in the entire range, and definitely I cannot compare our situation here to backwards countries or in Africa, the genital mutilation, not only because they believe that that keeps women pure, but because even mothers don't see future for their daughters, because the only future is to be married, to be fed and housed, is if she has to go through the genital mutilation. And they said genital mutilation is not a little nick. It's not something that we need to be politically correct about. It is a total excising of the entire genitalia. It is awful. So you're talking about 120 million women in Africa and the Middle East. So it exists in a variety of ways.
I want you to come back to the books, because you were about to tell me what drove you to do Jerusalem Maiden.
Jerusalem Maiden was inspired by my own grandmother's untapped artistic genius. My grandmother did fantastic embroidery and knitting and crocheting. We always laughed at in the family that you could not place a plate on her tablecloth, because every flower was actually a sculpted yarn. Looked like a field of blooming flowers, but you certainly was not conducive for a dinner. My mother became an artist, I mentioned, at the age of 42. I wanted to understand what happened to women with as talented. My grandmother's this untapped artistic genius, her mother had been, was it her mother or grandmother? She had been so smart that her father, who had been a rabbi, allowed her to sit outside the yeshiva, the cheder, where he was teaching the boys. This is in Jerusalem. So she could listen, and then married her off to his star pupil. That's the most he could see for a bright woman. I bring it a little bit in Jerusalem Maiden, as Esther herself is quite bright and listens to the Torah and Talmud, and she asks questions that even rabbis haven't even asked. Mm-hmm. She comes up with them. At any rate, I wanted to understand what happened to a young woman. Now, from there, I go into fiction. In fiction, I go to the extreme, as I did in China Doll. I go to the extreme. That's when you have a story to tell. I took it to the extreme and told a story that's not her story. My mother and her sisters, who had read the novel, said that I had nailed their mother completely without using a single scene and a single event from her life. I told a totally different story, but I told the frustration, the pain of being second to, in this case, her brother, who was being honored and in a bar mitzvah and so on and so forth. So that's the story. And
very nice. Okay. And now, what drives you to write your new novel, Hotel Moscow?
It came out of a totally different place, two different places. After leaving Russia in 1993, I wrote that night that the American embassy put me at an American hotel, safe hotel, and sent and got my luggage. I had packed my luggage but could not get it out of the room. They got my luggage. And I sat down to write my report to the USIA, U.S. Information Agency, that has sent me. This is pre-internet. I came home, and my poor husband, who had called our congressman, who put the State Department on alert, and was a whole big mess, my husband called everybody knew to tell them what was going on, and the phone would come ringing. And so I started sending this 23-page hard copy to everybody, mailing it. And on November 3rd, 1993, I sat down with a friend who was a journalist, female friend, and I said to her, here's the report, don't ask questions. All it needs is hot sex and I have a novel. So she said, why don't you write it? I said, okay. I went back to the office and at 2:48 started to type. And that's how my writing career began.
That's how it began?
Yeah, November 3rd, 1993 at 2:48 p.m.
So in some ironic way, Hotel Moscow was the first.
Yes.
It just didn't get published first.
Right. So I wrote not quite this novel. I wrote a novel about Russian women's lives. And in the next couple of years, I did tremendous amount of research to understand what had happened in terms of political situation and so on. And I wrote a novel about them, set in Russia, was narrated by a Russian, by a journalist. And that novel was actually agented, but the agent retired. Something happened in her family 6 weeks after taking on my novel.
What was it called?
Hotel Sputnik. And worse than being not being a virgin in Iraq for a woman, it is for a novel not to be a virgin in New York City. Because once it had been shown to a few publishers, no agent would touch it. That's it. By that time, I'd started, this is now, let's say, 95. I went to Beijing and so on. I'd started to write. I thought I was writing my Chinese-based novel. I put it aside, was writing my next one. So I definitely was very busy with writing. I didn't do anything with it, and I buried it away. Fast forward 20 years later, I'm on a book tour for Jerusalem Maiden, and I have a character that's been buzzing me in my head, an American, Jewish, secular woman, daughter of Holocaust survivors, who seems to have it everything but really doesn't. Really has very little inside, both because she carries pain and because she can't connect well with people who don't understand, and also having made mistakes trying so hard to flee that mission that she had to remember, where she was always a standing for her parents' lost families. I grew up with a lot of those second generations. They are my friends until today. They are so much part of my landscape, growing up in Israel with the mission to remember, that I carried that. I've seen their homes. I've been there. I could see the history. When I see my friends today, I can look back and see the homes and the families and relate to that. I was very close with my best friend, who's still my best friend. Her mother was a Holocaust survivor who always told me things. And she told me always knit bits and pieces. I never got the full story, and I didn't understand why I didn't get the full story. And I have a whole, as I grew up, I started to understand what she was hiding. But it was part of me, the stories, the Holocaust. So now I'm in New York, and I wanted to take her out of Israel, where she has identity the way I have an Israeli-Jewish identity, the way we discussed early. What is an American secular Jewish identity? What does it mean when it's unrelated to faith? I meet many who are not affiliated with a synagogue, a congregation, or atheists, and they say, I'm very Jewish. And I wanted to understand what it meant. And I think I found the answer. What comes through us, Jewish values. First of all, look at any civic or cultural organization, museum, program, music, whatever, and look at the name of the philanthropist to support it. You would never believe that Jews are only 2.5% of the population. I'm not talking Jewish causes, Jewish or even political. I'm talking civic and art. Look, it's Daka. What's Daka means? In one of my essays, it's going to appear in the blog of the Jewish Book Council. I'm breaking down Daka to its pieces. Only then I began to understand what Daka really means. But it is part of, it's a very important Jewish value. And also making the world a better place, contributing, giving. The other one is education. Rare is the home, Jewish home, that doesn't have books. But how many writers I meet today that are not Jewish and say there were no books in their homes? I never heard of a home that had no books. So the Jewish values come through in a variety of ways to the secular community. What Brooke Fielding, the protagonist, discovers when she meets unabashed anti-Semitism, she begins to be proud, but she doesn't know what she's proud of. But she feels pride, which is very interesting. And then I don't want to give out the book,
right.
But at the end, she's bigger than the anti-Semitism.
Yes, absolutely right.
She's able to put it aside. She's going to do some education when the time comes, when the moment is right. Right now, she deals with a project,
yes,
with what she needs to
yes.
do. But she risks her life to women who are anti-Semites. She risks physically, risks her life. And that's quite an interesting place for her to discover who she is.
It's a wonderful book, Hotel Moscow, that I hope everybody picks up. You're an extraordinary human being. And
thank you.
It's a delight talking to you. I have to have you back. There are so many issues that you are, it's not about being an expert, that you have experienced and you're competent in, that I want to draw upon your wisdom and again, your experience. But I wish you kol tuva hatzlacha in all
Thank
you do
you.
On so many levels. You have made a contribution that's extraordinary, Talia.
Thank you so
And I
much.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. It was a pleasure.
Thank you. Talia Carner, an amazing human being. She's not only the author of Hotel Moscow, published by HarperCollins. She has made a contribution to America, to women's issues globally, and it's an extraordinary opportunity for me to be able to present her to you. I hope you enjoyed hearing her insights as much as I did. And of course, as always, I ask you to be in touch with me with any thoughts or comments you may have, any reactions to any of the things that Talia had to say. Please email me, write me, post on my Facebook wall. I love Facebook. Or tweet me. I look forward to hearing from many of you. Until the next time, I'm Mark Golub. L'chaim, my friends, to life.
L'chaim is a presentation of Jewish Education in Media.
Complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.